We're back in Micah. There are four segments, four oracles. Each of the oracles sets up a problem, and the solution to each of the problems is a revelation of a coming Messiah. And actually, that makes perfect sense, because the only thing that will resolve the problems of the rebellion of Israel is, in fact, the Messiah. So I take you back now and pick up the second of our four boxes. If we start in the second, we need to remember that the judgment of God in the first box was justified. The judgment of God was justified because of the sin. And primarily, it was idolatry, theft, greed, harming of the weak in their society, and a society that had grown out of control. So Isaiah, Hosea, and Micah are all saying, Northern Kingdom, your time is short. You better get your act together. This isn't going to go much further. In the second segment, I want you to continue with the idea as we're looking through now the judgment. But the round two of the judgment is that leaders will be held in specific scrutiny as a result of the sinful behaviors of the people. So let's turn our attention now. First of all, let's ask the question, how does Randy know that? Just because he said it doesn't mean it's true. Well, take a look at chapter 3, verse 1. And I said, hear now, heads of Jacob, underline heads, and rulers of the house of Israel. So now you're dealing with leadership. Is it not for you to know justice? So one of the issues of the first box is going to be God is just because of the way that they're harming the weak. In the second box, it will be, do you not understand what justice is, and is it not your job to know? Now notice that there are standards that are mentioned in verse 2. So you might write the word standards next to verse 2. You who hate good and love evil, who tear off their skin from them and their flesh from their bones, who eat the flesh of my people, strip off their skin from them, break their bones, chop them up for the kettle and as meat in a kettle. In other words, standards are lost and cruelty seems to be rising. Make a note in your mind and your heart, if not your Bible, that when God's standards are set aside, cruelty will rise. There's a brutality that comes with godlessness. And one of my greatest fears for our nation is not simply that they're teaching a godlessness in the university, but that it is becoming a cruel godlessness, that it is becoming it's devoid of a conscience. And you see that happening in ancient Israel. And then it says that there is, they will cry out to the Lord, but he will not answer them. So this is a distance from God. In addition to cruelty, there's a distance from God that develops. Instead, he will hide his face from them at that time because they have practiced evil deeds. So obviously their practices are also a word I might write down. Practices that are causing them to continually symbolize the evil of their heart in a practice of everyday living. And God says, because of the standards and cruelty and distance and practices, here's what I want you to know. I won't listen to you crying out to me. There's coming a day when they will lead you away in chains, and I will go, not listening, not listening. You will cry, and I will not hear. Thus says the Lord concerning the prophets. Now, underline prophets in verse 5. What I would do is draw a line from prophets up to rulers and heads in verse 1, so that you catch that this whole box so far has been about leaders, 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 leaders. This is now spiritual word from God. Thus says the Lord concerning prophets who lead my people astray. When they have something to bite with their teeth, they cry peace. Now, I want you to picture, when does somebody in ancient society put something between their teeth? When they encounter pain without anesthesia, like they did in antiquity, they just say, okay, I'm going to pull this out, but you just, here, bite this. So when they're undergoing extreme pain, they're crying out, yes, it's peace. But against him who puts nothing in their mouths, they declare holy war. they can find a reason to fight on behalf of people who have done nothing for them. Now, I don't have to make a very solid image here, but we are watching in our country as the people who built the foundation of the morality are dissed, and people who were not here at the beginning, we are told, were the makers of our country. That's what he's talking about. He's talking about people who put nothing into it, but we laud them as the great help, and people who did all the work, we tell them they did nothing. Verse 6, therefore, it will be a night for you without vision, darkness for you without divination. The sun will go down on the prophets, and the day will become dark over them. God will withdraw any sense of insight from people who once had insight because they were willing to at least in some ways follow him. The further you get from listening to God's revealed truth, the darker your world will become, the less you will be able to see. There will be obvious moral breaches and moral penalties and ethical penalties, and you won't be able to see any of them. The seers will be ashamed. The diviners will be embarrassed. Indeed, they will all cover their mouths because there is no answer from God. On the other hand, I am filled with power, with the Spirit of the Lord, and with justice and courage to make known to Jacob his rebellious act. You see Micah insert in verse 8 his own sentence about himself. When I tell you the prophets will go dark, I'm not one of them. I know what God said, and I will preach what God said. And when they have nothing to say, when the pulpits are filled with people who are not speaking truth, I will keep preaching God's word, he says. I'll let Israel know about the rebellious act, even to Israel his sin. Now, hear this. Now, again, I have heads of the house of Jacob. So now I'm relating that to verse 1 and verse 5, and rulers of the house of Israel. But these aren't rulers who are righteous. They abhor justice. They hate things that are just and twist everything that is straight. I tell you, one of the things I found is, we talked about the complication that comes as you walk away from God. Nowadays, when you sit down and talk basic right and wrong to people, they're always so convoluted with, well, that's your idea or your culture. But you know, in their culture, wrong is really right. And therefore, none of us can really know. And you're sitting there talking to a person who's intelligent and stupid all at the same time. And here's what it says. Her leaders pronounce judgment for a bribe. Her priests instruct for a price, and her prophets divine for money. Yet they lean on the Lord, saying, is not the Lord in our midst? Here's what it is. Mark my words. As darkness falls on those who once gave God's word, they will do it for money. They will turn the doctrine into whatever prospers them. And they'll stand there and use God words, but if you look at their values, they don't have God values. And ultimately it says this, is not the Lord in our midst? Calamity will not come upon us. We're the people of God. Calamity's not coming. We're not going to be taken into captivity as they hear the chains coming. Therefore, on account of you, Zion will be plowed as a field. Jerusalem will become a heap of ruins, and the mountain of a temple will become a high place, high places of the forest. You get the feeling that at the end of this, it's leaders, 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 prophets, judges, kings, governors, all of them have stood against God. And so God is justified in the first box. In the second box, he's not only justified to deal with the people, he's justified to deal with leaders. Now, again, that's the problem, and you just got back from lunch and you shouldn't be going, oh, great, condemnation, way to go, but here's what you should do. This book gives us a beautiful look at the promises of Messiah. So he does it by creating this angst in the people. Now let's take a look at the second view of Messiah. The first one is he'll be both king and Lord. The first one is that a breach maker will go before him, and he will enter and they will know his qualifications to be both king and Lord as Messiah. The second one is found in the beautiful picture of verses 1 through 8 of chapter 4. Would one of you read those verses, please?
We'll find out about in the last days, for the mountain of the house of the Lord will be established as the chief of the mountains. It will be raised above the hills, and the peoples will stream to it. Many nations will come and say, come, and let us go up to the mountain of the Lord and the house of the God of Jacob, that he may teach us about his ways, that we may walk in his paths. From Zion will go forth the law, even the word of the Lord from Jerusalem, and he will judge between many peoples and render decisions for the mighty distant nations. Then they will hammer their swords into plowshares and their spears into pruning hooks. Nation will not lift up a sword against nation, and never again will they train for war. Each of them will sit under his vine and under his fig tree, and no one will make them afraid, for the mouth of the Lord of the hosts has spoken. Though all the peoples walk, each in his name of his God, as for us, we will walk in the name of the Lord our God forever and ever. In that day, declares the Lord, I will assemble the lame and gather the outcasts, even those whom I have afflicted. I will make the lame a remnant and the outcast a strong nation, and the Lord will reign over them in Mount Zion from now on and forever. As for you, tower of the flock, hill of the daughter of Zion, to you it will come. Even the former dominion will come in the kingdom of the daughter of Jerusalem.
I want you to go back and look at what Messiah is promising. God promised the Jewish people that the UN would relocate to Zion. And the world would look to the place that has been long associated with conflict and stabbing and bombing, and that will be the place the Prince of Peace resides. That the king was coming not just to the world, but to a specific place in the world, and Jerusalem would emerge to be a place of peace. The nations would see the God of Israel, the God of the universe, and war will become a thing of the past because disputes will be settled by truth. And they'll go from being an outcast to a strong nation. Why? Why is that going to happen? Why is he going to do those things? What does Israel do differently in the future that causes that to happen? They bow. They bow their necks. Quite literally, they submit to their king. A kingdom with strong submission and a righteous king is unstoppable by God, and that's what he's doing. Now, in this place, notice the time period he's talking about is the kingdom period. So we're going to talk about this later on, but there is an actual reign and rule of the Messiah promised on earth. If you were Jewish, and here in the first century, Jesus didn't look like this, but this is what they expected Messiah to be. That's because it's Messiah part two. There's also the other part, the part where he had to pay for sin. But here, go back to verse 1. Clearly, he's talking about the last days. How do I know? Because it says it's in the last days. Clearly, he's talking about Jerusalem. How do I know? Because it says the mountain of the house of the Lord will be established as the chief of the mountains. The temple will be the center of world focus. The United Nations will not be where peace comes from. It will be the mountain of the temple in Jerusalem. It will also be raised above the hills and the peoples will stream into it. There's coming a day when that mountain will so represent peace that people from around the world will want to see and be a part of what's going on there. Verse 2, it's not just Jews. Many nations will come and say, come, let us go up to the mountain of the Lord into the house of the God of Jacob. Why? Because he will teach us about his ways, that we may walk in his paths. So there'll be a very effective evangelism that goes out to the world that says, the one who's sitting on the throne of David is right and true. And like Solomon had people streaming in to the first temple from all over the world, in the third temple, it'll happen again. Verse 3 says that he will act as judge. Messiah's role will be not just king, not just Lord, we got those. He'll also be judge between people. He'll render decisions for mighty and distant nations, meaning during the kingdom period, international relationships will still operate. Brazil may still be Brazil, but sitting for 1,000 years on the throne of David will be the son of David, this one who has come, both Lord, Messiah, King, and people will stream in to see him. And during that time, nation will not rise up against nation because they will settle in that period. One of the things that happens is Satan is bound, and we'll talk about that in Revelation 20. But here, you can actually even write Revelation 20 alongside of this if you want to know when this occurs. But it says, everybody will sit down under his own fig tree and under his own vine. You should know that verse 4 has become a hope of modern Israel. What do people really want? Instead of two chickens in every pot, they want to sit under their own vine and their own fig tree. They want to have the basics that meet their needs. Remember the vine, much of the year, you don't get sufficient rainfall, so God provides the grapes, which make the wine, and so your grape vine is important to you. And your figs, because, do you remember as we were reading through the life of David, the men would become faint, or in Judges, they would become faint, and they would eat from the figs, and they would brighten up because of the sugars that are in them. And so they became very staple products. It's interesting because the whole thing is on the basis of this. No one will make them afraid in verse 4. In other words, for the history of the people of the Jews, they will be afraid of one thing after another. Messiah will come, end of fear. Nobody will make you afraid anymore. Joel is going to say no one will make you ashamed anymore of being who you are. So the things said of Israel for their future would be shame and fear and all kinds of problems. But Messiah comes and he says, that's it. Nobody looks down on you anymore. Verse 5 says, though all the peoples walk each in the name of his God, as for us, we will walk in the name of the Lord our God forever and ever. Meaning, Israel will go back to being identified not as the most liberal modern society on earth, but as the most godly society on earth, representing Yahweh, representing the Lord God of Israel. And they will be the people, sons of Abraham through Isaac, through Jacob, that God intended them to be. And in that day, verse 6, declares the Lord, I will assemble the lame and gather the outcasts, even as those whom I have afflicted, and I will make the lame a remnant and the outcasts a strong nation, and the Lord will reign over them in Mount Zion. I'm going to bring in people that were outcast in their society. They were the down and out in their society, but because they were my people, I'll gather them from all over the world, and I will take those outcasts and turn them into a strong and mighty nation as I'm their God. Verse 8, as for you, tower of the flock, hill of the daughter of Zion, to you it will come. Even the former dominion will come, the kingdom of the daughter of Jerusalem. So you see a restoration by Messiah of the stature of the Jewish people, of the encouragement to raise them up so that they're not downcast and set aside. A lot of positives there. But what you're looking for in Micah is how does that tell you more about qualifications of Messiah? So whatever you listed there on your column, just know that that's what you're really looking for. These are the qualities and character statements of the last days and how Jesus looks like when he returns. Okay? Now, we get to the third box, and the third box starts in 4:9. And 4:9 to 5:1, we're just going to pour through, but this judgment is judgment announced in round 3 that also ends in Messiah. And the problem is that the loss of leadership with a defining voice makes people wander. And beside that, God calls all the nations, Babylon and her friends, to arrive at the door. It seems like the people move away from God and they become more fuzzy in their thinking and there's less critical leadership and people aren't able to make good, solid decisions. Let me pick it out. God is calling in the nations in this box. So here, he's been dealing with Israel as a people and the leaders. Here he's going to deal with nations to deal with Israel. And I'll tell you where I picked that up. Verse 1, now muster yourselves in troops, daughter of troops. They have laid siege against us. With a rod they will smite the judge of Israel on the cheek. But as for you, Bethlehem Ephratah, too little to be among the clans of Judah, from you one will go forth for me to be ruler in Israel. His goings forth are from of old, from the days of eternity. Notice that I skipped the second half of 4, didn't I? I went right to the Messiah passage because I love that passage so much I skipped it. All right. Let me take you back and show you where I'm talking about the nations, and then I'll settle down and do what I'm supposed to do. In verse 9, chapter 4, verse 9, now why do you cry out loudly? Is there no king among you? Has there no counselor, has your counselor perished? I have so many notes in my Bible, it's hard to read. That agony has gripped you like a woman in childbirth? Writhe and labor to give birth, daughter of Zion, like a woman in childbirth. For now you will go out of a city, dwell in the field, and to Babylon. Notice it says that their people are crying out. They're crying out, and there doesn't appear to be, in verse 9, a king or a counselor. This is a tip-off that he's now looking past the Assyrians all the way to the Babylonian captivity of Judah. How do I know that? Because verse 10, and you go to Babylon. So he's prophesying now to a different group. You have to know that at the time he's saying this, Babylon is not yet the world power it will become. They're a rising power. Often in the prophets, they will talk about powers before their powers. And what's interesting here, it says, there you will be rescued. There the Lord will redeem you from the hand of your enemies. And now many nations have been assembled against you who say, let her be polluted, let our eyes gloat over Zion. But they do not know the thoughts of the Lord, and they do not understand his purpose. You might want to write next to verse 12, Habakkuk 1, verses 5 through 11. Habakkuk 1, do you remember Habakkuk? We actually did look at that earlier this year, and we talked about, Lord, you don't hear, you don't see. People are getting away with murder down here, and you're not doing anything about it. There's a direct correlation between the people who do not understand the thoughts of the Lord. It's easy for us to get to think that we understand God because we know some of his word. The truth is, his thoughts are not our thoughts. His ways are not our ways. He is higher than us. But look at this at the end of verse 12. For he has gathered them like sheaves into the threshing floor. Arise, thresh, daughter of Zion, for your horn I will make iron, and your hooves I will make bronze, that you may pulverize many peoples, that you may devote to the Lord their unjust gain and their wealth to the Lord of all the earth. This is talking about a time when the nations rise up, Babylon as a good picture of the world, rise up against Israel. They're about to crush Israel, and God gives Israel a strength that doesn't belong to Israel, and they overtake them and use the wealth of the nations to honor Messiah when he comes. A good view of this would be Revelation 19. And Israel is surrounded. They're getting creamed. He comes out with King of Kings and Lord of Lords written on his thigh. He speaks. He mows down the armies of the world, and Israel then gets to clean up the spoils of what has been left in the field and bring it into the kingdom. And what is the answer to that? Messiah. Messiah has come in verse 1. Now muster yourselves in troops, daughter of troops. They have laid siege against us. With a rod they will smite the judge of Israel on the cheek. So God is calling in the nations. You should see this. When Israel is judged in the end time, it will not be because God got fed up. It will be because God will deliberately call the nations to move against them when the time comes. He is going to call the shots on the time. Now, we can accept that for the church, because you already know. If the dead in Christ will rise first, and we which are alive and remain will be caught up together with him in the air when the trumpet sounds, you know that he's got to blow the trumpet. You don't blow it. You don't determine the time. The Father does. But what's harder is for Israel to understand when they're going through Holocaust and they're going through terrorism and they're going through the hatred of nations, that God will blow the whistle for Israel as well. And he will determine who's going to come against them and when they're done. Israel isn't fighting the nations. Israel isn't even fighting the enemy. Israel is fighting God. That's the difference between the believer and the unbeliever. You're not just wrestling against flesh and blood and wrestling against principalities and powers of darkness. When you decide to side against God, you're wrestling not with the enemy, but with God. That needs to be clear in your mind. Some of you go through difficult times, and it's not the enemy, it's God. It's because you're working for the enemy and against God. You can't be on both sides of this fight. So you declare what you're going to be. And as you walk with God, you move yourself over, and then the enemy comes at you, but you're standing on the Lord's side. That's a different kind of conflict than when you are doing wrong. And that's why both Peter and James make this point. When you suffer for doing evil, you're not suffering for Jesus. You're suffering for doing evil. Now, it goes on and says this. This is a great messianic prophecy. How many of you know Micah 5:2? But you, Bethlehem Ephrathah, though you be little among the thousands of Judah, out of you shall he come forth to me to be ruler in Israel. His going forth have been from the ages to the ages is actually how it translates. So there's this wonderful Christmas card for Jesus there, right? He comes from Bethlehem. Ephrathah is the fruitful place, the regional round in Judea. Therefore, he will give them up until the time when she who is in labor has borne a child. Then the remainder of his brethren will return to the sons of Israel. He will arise and shepherd his flock. In the strength of the Lord and the majesty of the name of God, they will remain, because at that time he will be great to the ends of the earth. This one will be our peace. Can you pick out from verses 1 to 5 both comings of Jesus? Can you see them? They are not at all clear in advance, but in retrospect, can you see them? Okay, what refers to his first coming? Bethlehem refers to his first coming. Good. What else? In the Bethlehem statement is the one who has been our ruler from the ages to the ages comes to Bethlehem. So there's a personalization of Jesus as the ruler coming to Bethlehem. But look at verse 3. How does he get there? This is a great Christmas passage, because it's not just that he's coming to Bethlehem, but that he's going to be a baby. That therefore he will give them up until the time when she who is in labor is born a child. God will stop talking to Israel until he sends the baby. How's the baby coming? Through a womb. So the promise of Messiah included a womb. The promise of Messiah included a mama. The promise of Messiah included Bethlehem. And then the promise of Messiah included then the remainder of his brethren will return to the sons of Israel. He'll rise and shepherd his flock. That's the second coming, not the first. He didn't shepherd his whole flock in the strength of the Lord, the majesty of the name of the Lord. They will not remain. Israel is not remaining in the strength and majesty of the Lord. They are a liberal nation that does not honor their own Bible. But they will. The second coming brings something different than the first coming. Can you all see it? I don't need you to get real eloquent with me. I just need to know if after lunch you can pick this out. First coming and second coming are both beautifully represented here. So in a way, the king and the counselors, are subservient to the nations. And what's the answer? He will be a king. He will be a counselor, and he will be a ruler of nations. In other words, the natural rulers of Israel are going to lose everything that Messiah will bring back with him. And you have both the first and the second coming here. So what have we learned about Messiah? We've learned that he will be king, which is a human institution, and he will also be Lord. That a poretz will come before him. What did we learn about him here? He'll be king, counselor, he'll have the ruler of nations, and he will come in two comings. What did we learn in 4:1 through 8 about him? What's the revelation of who Jesus is in 4:1 through 8? I'm king, Lord, king, counselor, here, judge. I'm the adjudicator, and from the temple will sit a judge. So here's what we see. The picture or sketch we have of Jesus is that he's going to come. A breach maker is going to come first. John the Baptist is that breach maker. And he's going to come as both king and Lord. We also know that one day he will be judge of the nations. He will come as king and counselor. He'll come once as a baby, a second time with all the nations coming before him. And that's why Isaiah will say his name will be called Wonderful, Counselor, Mighty God, Everlasting Father, Prince of Peace. They're all preaching at the same time. Isaiah's across town calling him Counselor. And here's Micah over here calling him the Lost Counselors and the one who comes to solve the lost counsels. Let's go into the last of our boxes. And I want to pick up chapter 5 in the second half. Did you notice the one will be our peace? At the first part of verse 5. So, Shalom comes to Yerushalayim, city of peace, through Jesus, Yeshua, through salvation, and the Savior who becomes the King. Now, the second half of the verse goes into the fourth box. Can you see that even, is your text divided between this one will be our peace and then when the Assyrian invades our land? I've never understood why they're both verse 5. I don't understand why somebody stopped and started a whole new thought And you might even have, is in your text the W of when the Assyrian darker? I can't figure out why they divided the passage where they did. I think it probably came down to something practical, like it fit on a printing press somewhere. I really don't know. But here's the thing. The fourth box begins this. When the Assyrian invades our land, not if the Assyrians invade our land. When the Assyrians invade our land, and you should put in parentheses again, because Tiglath-Pileser III had already been there. Then came Shalmaneser, or Shalmaneser V. And by the time this thing is finally stripped down, it'll be Sennacherib who comes. So they've come through in waves several times. When the Assyrians invade our land again, when he tramples on our citadels, then we will raise against him 7 shepherds and 8 leaders of men. They will shepherd the land of Assyria with the sword, the land of Nimrod at its entrances, and he will deliver us from the Assyrian when he attacks our land and when he tramples our territory. Then the remnant of Jacob will be among many peoples, like dew from the Lord, like showers on vegetation, which do not wait for man or delay for the sons of man. The remnant of Jacob will be among the nations, among many peoples, like a lion among the beasts of the forest, like a young lion among the flocks of the sheep. Here's what I want you to see. God promised that after the Assyrians continually invade our land, there's coming another time when we will be scattered among the nations. And that scattering, the remnant of Jacob, will be thrown out there among the nations. And in verse 7, they will be scattered so that they grow, so that they deepen. And in verse 8, the rise of the Jew. Literally, the remnant of Jacob will be among the nations, but they will be like kings out, the king of the jungle out in the jungle. They'll be like lions in the jungle, meaning God will sculpt out of them. Listen, you cannot deny one reality of this. Though Jews represent less than 1% of the population of the globe, the vast majority of Nobel Prizes have been, the largest number of single people groups that have ever been given prizes were Jews. An inordinate number of them. You can't have a quarter of the Nobel Prizes going to people that are less than 1% of the population and not recognize the hand of God on them. And that's not because they believe, it's while they don't believe. So this is what he promised. You're going to be scattered, but God's going to have his hand on your life. There's going to be a progress in your life. And then it goes on and says, which if he passes through, tramples down and tears, and there is none to rescue it. Your hand will be lifted up against your adversaries, and all your enemies will be cut off. There's coming a day where you will be in desperate situation, and then there's another day where you will be able to defeat them as they come against you, and they will not understand why they can't beat you. God has promised both things to them. It will be in that day, declares the Lord, that I will cut off your horses from among you. I'll destroy your chariots. I will cut off the cities of your land. I will tear down all your fortifications. I'll cut off your sorceries, your fortune tellers, your sacred pillars. Go all the way down to verse 14. I will root out your Asherim, and I will execute vengeance in anger and wrath on the nations which have not obeyed. Look at verse 15, circle nations. He's not just talking about them. He's saying, I'm going to cut off from the tribulation all of your sorceries, fortune-telling, sacred pillars, idolatry, all of that. But I'm also going to thresh the nations along with you. So remember in Revelation 6 through 19, the nations are judged alongside of Israel, and God is coming down on the whole earth, not just them. It's for them, but it's to everyone. Does that make sense? This is the first place you start to see any focus on the tribulation. You're all the way at the end of 5 before you've seen that at all. And I think it's important for us to remember that he does carry through. Now, the difficulty is it's not linear. He'll say something about the kingdom, then I'll go back to the tribulation, then I'll go to the kingdom, then I'll go to the tribulation, then I'll go to the... Yeah, and so you're all over the place in timelines. But the facts are there. If you take the facts and hang them alongside on the line, you may have to reorder them because Micah doesn't know the order. But the facts are there. And later, as you're exposed to more scripture, you'll see that the order is given elsewhere. The facts are presented before the order is given. I said something important. In prophecy, often the facts are given long before the order is known. Okay? So in every prophet, just remember this, the facts are given, not necessarily the order. You have to go through the long view of Scripture to get the order. Okay? Keep going. You pick up at chapter 6, hear now what the Lord is saying. Arise, plead your case before the mountains, and let the hills hear your voice. Listen, you mountains, to the indictments of the Lord, and you enduring foundations of the earth, because the Lord has a case against his people. Even with Israel he will dispute. My people, what have I done to you? And how have I wearied you? Answer me. Indeed, I brought you up from the land of Egypt and transformed you from the house of slavery, and I sent before you Moses, Aaron, Miriam, my people. Remember now what Balak the king of Moab counseled and what Balaam the son of Beor answered him, and from Shittim and Gilgal, so that you might know the righteous acts of the Lord. God goes back and says, look, you're telling me that I've put a heavy burden on you. Can you tell me where? Because I have rescued you at every turn and dumped revelation on you. How have I done wrong by you? Stop. This is all easy to take shots at Israel because we're not them. So we can sit here and go, yeah, they were wrong. Have you come to the place in your life ever where you have felt what God is asking for you to surrender is too much? Is there any believer here that would not confess that at some point you thought, now look, God, I'm okay with living for you like in some areas, but come on now, you're asking for something that's more than, have you ever done that? That's exactly what they did. And God's answer is, I saved you. I saved you. See, the problem with men is that they look at time in temporal terms. The problem with God is he looks at people in eternal terms. So, when you're 100 million years old, that 100 years you had on the planet won't look as big, is what I'm saying. And so when you see it the way God sees it, he goes, I saved you, man. I saved you 100 million, billion, trillion years in darkness. And you can't give me 5, 10, 50 years? You can't? That's too much? Why is that too much for me to ask? I gave my son. Why is what I'm asking? I'm asking you to give up your dating life and turn it over to me. I'm not asking you to, you know, necessarily at this point in your life, have them drive nails in your hands. That's what it costs to get you. I'm asking the question, why is it too much to ask you to let me pick your college? Why is that too much? But I think everybody in this room, every one of us, interacts and understands this. God, when he presented it to Israel, was like, I don't get why you think that that's okay. Where did I leave off? 5? End of 5? With what shall I come to the Lord and bow myself before the God on high? Shall I come to him with burnt offerings, with yearling calves? Does the Lord take delight in the thousands of rams, in 10,000 rivers of oil? Shall I present my firstborn for my rebellious acts, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? By the way, underline fruit of my body for the sin of my soul. That is a classic line used in a number of poems in English history. But it really, what does God really want? Put next to verse 6 and 7, what is God really asking for? What do I give him? This is the little drummer boy. What do I have to give the king? What exactly? I don't have anything to give the king. And then put a box around verse 8, because the box around verse 8 is huge, guys. He has told you, oh man, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you? But to do justice and to love kindness and to walk humbly with your God. Listen, people use that verse in society to say, like, be a humble person. That's not what he said. He said, walk humbly before your God, meaning I get to tell you what to do. You keep asking me what it is I want. I want you. I want the choices of your daily life. That's what I want. I've told you every way I know how to tell you. That's what I want. Why can't you give me what I want? You give me religion. You build churches. You build cathedrals. You spend big bucks. You have gold gilding and icons. That's not what I want. I want you. Why can't I have you? What's wrong with you that you don't understand what I'm really asking? And it reminds me of David saying, you know, I'm going to build a temple, and God going, I don't remember asking you to do that. Why do you keep giving me things I didn't ask you for? And the answer is because I'm still in control when I give you what I want to give you rather than give you what you asked for. And the thing I don't want to give up is my control. So that's what I do. Even in doing good, we can do evil. Simply by doing it to call the shots on our relationship rather than let God be God. When the church decides that it's going to tell God what worship is, then they will do it the way the church wants to do it, whether God likes it or not. When the church decides that they know what benevolence is, it won't make any difference whether it's what God told them to do, if that's what they want to do. And they will console themselves in religiosity that is not relationship and is not submission. He has told you what the Lord requires. It is to do justice. That is to be straight with God and with other people. To love kindness, not to be kind, but to love kind people, kind things, kind ways. To cherish and value kindness and to submit before God and walk in humility before God and do what He told you to do. That's what He's asking. I don't think that there's a better verse in Scripture that describes what God wants than verse 8. I think that is as good as it gets. Micah 6:8. Learn that one, staple it on your head, do whatever you have to do to make sure that you're going, what is it God wants? You're going to have a young person, I just don't know what God wants. Read him this. It's as simple as you get and as powerful and hard to do as it gets. Verse 9. The voice of the Lord will call to the city, and it is sound wisdom to fear your name. Hear, O tribe, who has appointed its time? Is there yet a man in the wicked house along with treasures of wickedness and a short measure that is cursed? Can I justify wicked scales and a bag of deceptive weights? Her residents speak lies, and their tongue is deceitful in their mouth. So also I will make you sick, striking you down, desolating you because of your sins. I would write next to verse 13, 1 Corinthians 11. Because of the way you're handling the body of Christ, some of you are sick and some of you have died. Here it's because you are handling each other in lying scales and cheating each other in the marketplace. Some of you are sick and some of you have died. Verse 14, you will eat, but you will not be satisfied. And your vileness will be in your midst. The word vileness, what's a nice way to say this? Your sewage will be in your midst, okay? He's saying you're going to be standing knee-high in poop. That's what he's trying to say. And he said, here's the thing. You're going to eat, but you're not going to be satisfied. And it's going to stink where you are. You will try to remove for safekeeping, but you will not preserve anything. And what you do preserve, I will give to the sword. You're going to try to put aside some money, and you're going to be so lost in how to put it aside, somebody else is going to get it anyway. A war is going to come through and take everything you have. In other words, try walking without me, and you will end up with nothing. Verse 15, you will sow, but you will not reap. You will tread the olive, but you will not anoint yourself with oil, and the grapes, but you will not drink wine. You'll keep doing all the work, but you won't get the labors. The statutes of Omri and all the works of the house of Ahab are observed, and in their devices you walk. Therefore, I will give you up for destruction and your inhabitants for derision, and you will hear the reproach of my people. Woe is me! I'm like the fruit pickers, like the grape gatherers. There's not a cluster of grapes to eat or a first ripe fig which I crave. I'm working hard, but I'm getting nowhere. I'm doing the work every day, but I'm not getting any of it. It's all going to someone else. My taxes are eating me alive. Everything's taking it away from me. Verse 2, the godly person has perished from the land, and there is no upright person among men. All of them lie in wait for bloodshed. Each of them hunts the other with a net. people are all in it for themselves, trapping one another, and the godly people have been run out. They've run them out of business, and now they're shocked that there aren't any honest business people. How shocking. Verse 3, concerning evil, both hands do it well. They become so good, they're ambidextrous evil people. I can do evil with the left. I can do evil with the right. I can do it with my eyes closed. I can do it behind my back. They're just good at evil. And people become better and better and better at it. And then he says, the prince asks also the judge for a bribe. And a great man speaks the desire of his soul, so they weave it together. It means the rich collude with the justice system, collude with the government, and they take everything they can from you, and nobody's looking out for the people. You can't imagine a society like that. And then it says that the best of them is like a thorn bush, a briar. The most upright is like the thorn hedge. The day when you post your watchman, your punishment will come. Then their confusion will occur. Do not trust in a neighbor. Do not have confidence in a friend. This is three words, trust no one. When the day comes and it all falls apart, trust no one. From her who lies in your bosom, guard your lips. Don't even speak it to the people closest to you. Don't tell them what you think. Keep it to yourself. For son treats father contemptuously. Daughter rises up against her mother. Daughter-in-law against her daughter-in-law, her mother-in-law. Right next to that, Matthew 10 and Matthew 11. Because Matthew 10 and 11 will remind you, Jesus uses this phrase later on. He says, I did not come to make people stay together. I came to bring a sword. And then he says, mother-in-law against daughter-in-law and daughter-in-law against mother-in-law. It sounds weird. He's quoting Micah. He's quoting it out of a prophet. A man's enemies are the men of his own household. This is pretty bad. But in the last box, what we see is dissolution of family. And it becomes, whether you're a believer or an unbeliever, family falls apart. Now watch in verse 7 because he goes personal. But as for me, see the personal? I will watch expectantly for the Lord. I will wait for the God of my salvation. My God will hear me. Do not rejoice over me, O my enemy. Though I fall, I will rise. Though I dwell in darkness, the Lord is a light for me. This right next to that, Isaiah 7, 8, and 9. The Lord will bring a light where there was darkness. And though you think I'm done and I'm kicked out and Israel is finished and I'm scattered in the nations, out of the world will come light back into the land of the Gentiles and God will restore. But I love, notice that the believer's response to the dissolution of the family was what in verses 7 and 8? I'm going to walk with God and I'm going to keep hoping. I'm going to look forward with great positive anticipation. The anticipation of the prophet was not to, he knew the family would fall apart. He knew it. How can you look at the dissolution of your nation and the dissolution of your families and still have hope? Because your hope comes from the Lord. It doesn't come from your family. It doesn't come from your nation. And the problem is we have a lot of American Christians that are more American than Christian. Their hope comes from a flag, not from a God. Their hope comes from a constitution, not from a Bible. And the problem is you can't trust anything but God in His Word. Now it says, I will bear the indignation of the Lord because I have sinned against Him until He pleads my case and executes justice for me. He will bring me out to the light and I will see His righteousness. Then my enemy will see, and shame will cover her who said to me, where is the Lord your God? My eyes will look on her. At the time, she will be trampled down like the mire of the streets or the dung of the streets. It will be a day for your building your walls. On that day will your boundary be extended. It will be a day when they will come to you from Assyria and cities of Egypt and from Euphrates, even sea, and mountain, and let me see, even from the sea to sea and mountain to mountain, and the earth will become desolate because of her inhabitants on account of the fruit of their deeds. You stop and you go as far as verse 13, and at the end of it, he says, I take encouragement, and I also take personal responsibility for the sin of my people. I'm not saying those people, I'm saying we. I'm not casting off my people, I'm personally. You know what? It occurs to me that whereas in verse 7 he's expectant, and in verse 8 he's rejoicing, in verse 9 he's personal and repentant. In verse 10, he's encouraged by the fact that his repentance will yield a time when God will restore. He won't listen to people say, well, if God was your God, why are you living the way you're living? Stay tuned. God is my God, and it will change. So there's a hopefulness in him. And at the end, we get to the last picture of Messiah. This is a picture, and it's a picture different than the other three balloons at the bottom. Shepherd your people with your scepter, the flock of your possession, which dwells by itself in the woodland, in the midst of a fruitful field. Let them feed in Bashan and Gilead, as in the days of old, as in the days when you came out from the land of Egypt, I will show you miracles. Nations will see and be ashamed of all their might. They will put their hand on their mouth. Their ears will be deaf. They will lick the dust like a serpent, like reptiles of the earth. They will come trembling out of their fortresses to the Lord our God. They will come in dread, and they will be afraid before you. Now stop right there. Before we go on, what title is picked up here that Messiah has that is not given on the other three balloons?
Shepherd.
So I want to add to my menu, King, Lord, Judge, King, Counselor, Shepherd. If I were to come as this guy and say, I am the good shepherd, I might be leaning into this, right? So John 10 might have something to do with Micah and the promise that a shepherd is going to come. But he didn't come with his scepter, he came with his staff, right? Now, he's going to come again as shepherd, but shepherd king. Shepherd with a scepter. Now, look at where it says they are. Bashan is the Golan Heights. Gilead is the modern kingdom of Jordan. And it says that nations will come and bow down and be afraid of Israel for the sake of her shepherd king. They will come and see righteousness there. They will come and marvel at what they have become. And they will not marvel against the Jewish people. They will marvel against the Jewish people in deference to their God. Listen to verse 18. Who is like you, who pardons iniquity and passes over the rebellious acts of the remnant of his possession? This is like Exodus 15:11. Micha mocha, who is like you? Be'elim Adonai, who is like you, O Lord among the gods? Do you remember? This is a very famous song that comes from the writings of Moses, a song of Moses. Who is like you, O Lord? And so he says, he harkens back to Moses in Exodus 15:11, and he comes back and he says, who is like you, who pardons iniquity and passes over the rebellious acts of the remnant of his possession? Who does what our God does and takes a wretched people that has stood up against him for generations, pardons them, brings them back, hugs them, makes them such a people that the world looks at them and says, will you look at them? Who does this? Who loves anybody that much? And then he ends his prophecy with, he passes over the rebellious acts. He does not retain his anger forever because he delights in unchanging love. By the way, the unchanging love is his love, not the people's. What he's saying is the people are fickle, God isn't. Where the people are fickle, God is faithful. Where the people are constantly changing, God is unchanging. And then he goes on and he says, he will again have compassion on us. He will tread our iniquities underfoot. Yes, you will cast all their sins into the depths of the sea. You will give truth to Jacob, unchanging love to Abraham, which you swore to our forefathers from days of old. It's interesting because God swore to Abraham in Genesis 22 and to Jacob in Genesis 28 that their descendants would be as numerous as the sands of the sea. Look at this. He goes back and picks out Jacob, and he goes back and picks out Abraham from Genesis. And he hangs the coming of Messiah and the settling of the people of Israel back on the promises he made to Abraham and to Jacob. Now, what do you learn about Messiah from the end of the book? I already know that he's going to come with a breach maker and he's going to be king and Lord. I already know he's going to be king and counselor. I even know when I look back that he's going to be the one who's going to be a ruler over the nations and he's going to be a righteous judge. But now I learn he's going to be a shepherd and he's going to be an ingatherer, that the scattered seed of Jacob that went all over the world will be gathered in. And when he gathers them in, he'll overlook the terrible sin after the time of the tribulation, gathering them back, and he'll delight in them. And the world will look at them and say, wow, their God was really who they said he was. And their God reigns and their God saves. What you learn about him is that at the end, the name Micah is who is like Yahweh. And so this simple, who is God like you, becomes a play even on his own name. They learn that Micah's lesson is, who is like you? Well, let me tell you who you are. And he tells you about Messiah.